Okay, we are live. This is a live event here on Jason Byrne's YouTube channel. It's a debate between DPRjones and Jason Byrne's. I am your moderator, the Bible Thumping Wingnut. And Jason, if you can mute your microphone as we begin here. I just wanted to make a few things clear as we get started. First, bear with me. I've never moderated before, but this should be fun, and I'm going to give it my best shot. You can communicate with me, sending me questions and comments on my Skype account. You can connect with me on Skype. It's the Bible Thumping Wingnut on Skype. That is the only way that I'm going to be receiving questions for the question period of this debate, so please do send questions on that Skype feed, the Bible Thumping Wingnut. So welcome, and the topic of this debate is Christianity true? And the two debaters, as I said before, DPRjones and Jason Byrne's, and I believe I put the format in the description box of this Google Hangout for those of you who I'll go over it real quick just so we can all know where we're going. We're going to have 20 minutes each of opening statements, followed by a rebuttal of 10 minutes from each, and then cross-examination for 10 minutes for each. At that point, we'll be at least 80 minutes into this Google Hangout. We may have a break if needed. If not, we will continue with a 30-minute time period of questions. Though, like I said, those questions will be received to me or sent to me from you. So send those to the Bible Thumping Wingnut on Skype, and I'll be and send them to me as soon as you think of them, because that way I can arrange them. Don't wait until the question time. So please send them ahead of time. I appreciate that. So after the 30 minutes of questions from the audience, then we will proceed with closing statements. And that's the way it's going to go. And let me think if I left anything out. To the two participants, when you're not speaking, please mute your microphone. And also, if I do this correctly, I'll be having a clock. I'll share a screen of a clock here, so that you know how many minutes are left. I won't have to interrupt you and show you how much time is left on the clock. Anything I missed, guys, or any questions?
I'd rather not see the clock. I can count time, but I appreciate the offer.
The, I don't need to see it because
I much prefer seeing the person I'm addressing.
You will be seeing yourself when you speak, and down in the very bottom corner will be the timer.
Okay, so I understand. Could I just add one thing, if I may?
Sure.
I'm likely to sacrifice some of my time in the sections that we have, because I suspect that there is nothing new or interesting that is going to be presented by either of us, that's to say Jason and myself. And I would much rather, I think it's much more interesting as well, to have questions from the audience. So, provided Jason is willing to do so, if possible, I'd like the question time to be extended. But let's see how we get along.
Sounds like a plan. So we will, as for now, we'll stick to the format
sure.
as we agreed on, and we'll see how it. We proceed from there. So,
Tim?
Yes.
What about break? Are we having a break in between?
Yep. There's an opportunity for a break after about an hour and a half.
Is that okay, DP? Because
it's entirely a matter for you. I'm sure at some stage I may have to go to the bathroom. So it's entirely a matter for you, Jason. I've got no problem with that.
If that's okay, I'd like a break, if that's okay. Thanks.
Sure.
Okay.
Just tell us when you want your break, Jason.
All right, thanks. Well, whatever Tim says.
All right, with that said, we will begin. This first portion is opening statements. 20 minutes is allotted for each. And Jason Burns will go first. And again, the topic of this debate is Christianity true? And with that, you can begin, Jason.
Okay. In John chapter 18:38, Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him." So what is truth? That's the first thing we have to consider. We've got to consider epistemology and knowledge on what is properly justified true belief. Now, what exactly does this mean? It's important for you and I to understand the simple little equation, because our knowledge of all things, including our knowledge of spiritual matters, comes down to whether or not we hold to properly justified true beliefs. So let's examine the definition more precisely. Belief. Let's face it, you can't know something unless you believe it. You can't know that there is a God unless you believe that God exists. But my belief is simply not enough. It is insufficient. You and I both believe things that are simply untrue. It is possible for us to have false beliefs, and people who believe something what is false often think that they know it. But there is a difference between believing and knowing. So what is true? Most of us like to think that we hold to truth, yet what someone presses us to define what is truth, we might have a hard time trying to define. How do we determine what is true? There are a number of theories of truth. The pragmatic theory of truth, that which is the notion that what works is true. Then there is the empiricist theory of truth. That is to say that what is our experience verifies what is truth. There is emotive theory of truth. That is to say that our emotions and the way we feel verifies what is true. Then there is the correspondence theory of truth. This is a classic definition of truth, the theory that what is related to reality is what is true. Now, just because something is true doesn't necessarily mean that it is knowledge. It has to be properly justified. Okay, so what is justification? Justification is a sufficient, establish a truth is properly justified. What that means is it has to be based in evidence. What is evidence? Evidential sufficiency. That is to say that evidence has to be given that is of sufficient quality. However, even though we present our arguments and say this is true because of quality evidence, there is always the issue of circular reasoning. Cornelius Van Til said, all reasoning is in the nature of the case circular reasoning. The starting point, the method and conclusion are always involved in one another. Van Til, The Defense of the Faith, page 101. So, if we're going to justify our beliefs, it's got to be based on evidence, but also there's got to be a recognition there is a circular understanding of reasoning. And so therefore there has always been a debate in history between the rationalist and the empiricist, between a priori and between the a priori. And then there is the I've lost my notes here. An a posteriori, that is to say that knowledge is based on in intuition and general principles. So in other words, there has been a debate throughout history between empiricism and rationalism. And what I'm saying, if you're going to base your belief on truth, what is the truth? It's got to be based on, number one, evidence, but also a recognition that evidence is not enough. There is circular reasoning, and you've got to justify your circular reasoning. And I believe that Christianity is based not just on empiricism, but it's also based on presuppositions. And Jesus says, it says in the Bible, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the only one and Son, who came from the Father full of grace and truth. This can be verified in experience and in science and in knowledge that's verified with evidence, but it also needs an ontological status. Secondly, we need to define what is Christianity. In Mark chapter 10:45, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for many. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life, John 3:16. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name, Acts 10:43. In other words, the gospel, the Christian faith, is about Jesus Christ being punished for our sin, taking the wrath of God for our sin, so that we can know forgiveness of sins, and that is the gospel. So when we say, what is Christianity true, we have to define our epistemology, and we have to define what Christianity is. And Christianity is the gospel. C.H. Spurgeon says, the hearing of the gospel includes the hearer is responsible. It is a great privilege to hear the gospel. You may smile and think there is nothing very great in it. The damned in hell know. Oh, what would they give if they could hear the gospel now, if they could come back and entertain but the shadow of hope that they might escape from the wrath to come. C.H. Spurgeon. The saved in heaven estimate this privilege at a high rate, for having obtained salvation through the preaching of his gospel, they can never cease to bless their God for calling them by his word. Oh, that you knew it, oh, your dying beds, then listening to a gospel sermon will seem another thing that seems now. So we've defined what epistemology is, we've defined what Christianity is, but let's now look at a couple of important issues. Number one, my first argument is presuppositions. First of all, DPRjones represents what I would call scientism. The physicist Stephen Hawking in 2010 says what scientism is. What is the nature of reality? Where did all things come from? Did the universe need a creator? Traditionally, these are questions for philosophy, but philosophy is dead. Notice this. Philosophy is dead. Philosophy has not kept up with the modern diplomats. In science, properly physics science, have become the bearers of a torch of discovery in our quest for knowledge. Did you hear that? Hawkins is saying that knowledge is based in science, right? Listen to this. Knowledge is based in science, but that is not true. Greg Banson has noted that there is more to knowledge than just science. We have to deal with presuppositions. Greg Banson writes, a presupposition is an elementary assumption in one's reasoning, or a process by which opinions are formed. In this book, a presupposition is not just any assumption in an argument, but a personal commitment that is held at the most basic level of one's networks of beliefs. Presuppositions form a wide-ranging foundational perspective or starting point, in terms of which everything else is interpreted and evaluated. At such presuppositions of the greatest authority in one's thinking being treated as one's least negotiable beliefs and being granted the highest immunity to revision. Banson, Van Til's Apologetic. All the resources here you can get on Presuppositional Apologetics 101 website. So what does that mean? What that means is our presuppositions have to be discussed before we get to evidence. And one of the presuppositions is about logic. How do we know that our logic that we use is actually the right way to use logic? My argument is here. No logical absolutes without God. Listen, no logical absolutes without God. We have logical absolutes, therefore there is a God. Aristotle did work on the law of non-contradiction. He says, logical, the most certain of all basic principles is that of the contradiction proposition are not true simultaneously. In other words, one of the basic logical foundations of knowledge is the law of non-contradiction. Now listen carefully. The law of non-contradiction says something cannot be the same in the same context. A cannot be B in the same context. Okay? Now, if logic is based, the law of non-contradiction, if it is based in the material, that means logic is changing. And unfortunately for DPRjones, his basic epistemology is all there is the material. So therefore, logic changes. If logic changes, then he cannot object to me because logic is arbitrary. Logic does not change because you cannot actually smell logic. You cannot weigh logic. And logic is intentional. Therefore, shows us there is a God, a personal God. Secondly, if God does not exist, objective morals do not exist. Objective moral values do exist, therefore God exists. Premises 1, Jean-Paul Sartre verifies this first premises. He talks about when we speak of abandonment, a favorite word of Heidegger, and he goes on and on and on, but he says it is nowhere written, here it is, that good exists.
that one must be honest or must not lie, since we are now upon the plane where there are only men. Dostoevsky once wrote, if God did not exist, everything would be permitted. So even atheists verify that if we take the atheist position, there is no moral absolute. Secondly, that moral absolutes do exist. In order to deny the proposition that moral absolutes do not exist, you have to say that moral absolutes do exist. Do you get it? If you say that moral absolutes do not exist, you are making a moral absolute. So then we go on to why this shows us there is a God. It says, G.E. Ancom, Modern Moral Philosophy, Virtue, Ethics, says, beyond its objectivity, what is sometimes called the moral law is not analogous to the scientific concept of physical laws. When I trip up, falling is something I am caused to do. Nothing, not something I am obliged to do. The moral law, on the other hand, prescribes but does not cause. Actions that I am obliged to do or to refrain from doing. While I never fail to obey the law of gravity, I often fail to do the right thing. A physical law describes what is the case and can be used to predict what will be the case, but it doesn't prescribe what ought, here's the key, what ought to be the case, as does not the moral law. Now, as Francis J. Beckwith and Gray Cocci observe, a command only makes sense when there are two minds. Here it is. A command only makes sense when there are two minds involved, one giving the command and one receiving. If an objective moral law has the property of being a command that we receive, then there must be an objective personal moral commander beyond individual or collective humanity. As G.M. Atcom affirmed concerning objective moral law, naturally it is not possible to have such a conception unless you believe in God as a lawgiver. Like Jews, Stoics, and Christians, you cannot be under a law unless it has been promulgated to you. G.M. Anscombe, Modern Philosophy, Virtue, Ethics, etc., Oxford, 1997. So we'll leave it there on there. Now for the evidence. So we've looked at number one, presuppositions, logic. How do we know what is logic? We've looked at that. The atheist position is material. If it's material, all things change, therefore logic changes. Okay? So he can't object to me. Secondly, we've looked at moral absolutes. If he says there are no moral absolutes or moral absolutes, he has to ground it epistemologically in something, and you can't, as you know, get from an ought to an is, and this is the problem that DPRjones has. Now, the argument for the resurrection, the minimal facts argument, resurrection of Christ. Anthony Flew, when he was an atheist, said, the evidence of the minimal facts of the resurrection is better than for claimed miracles in any other religion. It is outstanding in different quality and quantity. Hallelujah! What a savior! Now, the minimal fact approach is based on objective history. We all have presuppositions, but we've got to try and put those aside and look at history in an objective way. We'll all be colored, by the way, atheist and Christian, as we look at history. But let's look at history as best we can in an objective way. So how do we do that? We look at history based on the secular historian's method. Number one, historical claims are strong when supported by multiple independent sources. Number two, historical claims which are also attested by enemies are more likely to be authentic, since enemies are unsympathetic and often hostile witnesses. Number three, historical claims which include embarrassing admissions reflect honest reporting rather than creative storytelling. Number five, historical claims are strong when supported by eyewitness testimony. And number five, historical claims which are supported by early testimony are more reliable than less likely to be the result of legendary development. Number one, can we verify that Jesus died on a cross? Perhaps no other fact surrounding the life of the historical Jesus is better attested than his crucifixion. Woo, that's amazing, my friends. But it is also confirmed by several historical verifications. They include Jewish historian Josephus, the Roman historian Tacitus, the Greek satirist Lucian of Samosata, and the Jewish Talmud. Josephus tells us that Pilate, at the suggestion of the principal men among us, condemned him to the cross. From a perspective of historiography, Jesus' crucifixion meets the historical criteria of multiple independent and early eyewitness sources, including enemy attestation. That's why the critic, yes, I'd say the critic, Dominic Crossan, says, non-Christian critical scholar and founder of the Jesus Seminar, states that he was crucified as sure as any historical fact can be. And then objection number two, didn't he really die? Well, you could have the swoon theory, but as the great scholar, German scholar David Friedrich Strauss explains, it is impossible that a being who had stolen half dead out of the sepulchre, who crept about weak and ill, wanting medical treatment, who required banging and strengthening and indulgence, who still at least yielded to his suffering, could have given to the disciples the impression that he was a conqueror of death and the grave and the prince of life, and the impression which lay at the bottom of their future ministry. Such a resuscitation could only have weakened the impression which he had made upon them in life and in death. At the most, could only give it an elegiac voice, but could by no means possibly have changed their sorrow into enthusiasm. In other words, when the disciples saw this so-called swoon Jesus, they would not have been pressed to go and preach about him. Secondly, the empty tomb is a well-historical fact. I say that again. It's a well-attested historical fact. Oh, my friends, you need to do studies in historical studies, and the atheists do not do it, my friends. But let's get on. Something happened to the body of Jesus. What happened to it? Not only was Jesus publicly executed in Jerusalem, but his post-mortem appearances in empty tomb were first publicly proclaimed there. This would have been impossible with a decaying corpse still in the tomb. It would have been wholly un-Jewish, notes William Lane Craig, not to say foolish, to believe that a man was raised from the dead when his body was still in the grave. The Jewish authorities had plenty of motive to produce a body and silence the men who turned the world upside down, effectively ending the Christian religion for good, but no one could. The only early opposing theory recorded by the enemies of Christianity is that the disciples stole the body. Ironically, that proves the empty tomb. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! James Dunn, one of the great scholars of modern world, says this. It is very plausible, historical character. He's attested in all four Gospels, and in the Gospel of Peter, when the tendency of the tradition was to shift blame to the Jewish council, the creation of ex nihilo, of a sympathizer from among their number, would be surprising. And Arimathea, a town very difficult to identify and reminiscent of no scriptural symbolism, makes a thesis of invention more implausible. Atheist Jeffrey Lauder agrees that a burial of Jesus by Joseph of Arimathea has a high final probability. My friend, I could go on and on and on about the historical fact of the empty tomb of Jesus. I could go on and on, but I will not. I'll go to the next issue. The disciples stole the body. The fraud or conspiracy theory. First, the theory does not explain well the implicitly of the resurrection narratives, nor why the disciples would invent woman as the primary witness to the empty tomb. This is hardly the way one gets a conspiracy theory off the ground. And may I just say to DPRjones, if he wants to take me on the issue of women, go ahead, my friend. Go ahead, my dear. Second, this is also doesn't explain why the disciples would perpetuate a story that they stole the body, Matthew 28:11-15, if in fact they stole the body, propagating an explanation which incriminates oneself is again at odds with the conspiracy theory. Third, as will be discussed below, this theory does not account for the fact that the disciples of Jesus, here it is, has genuine experience which they believe they saw the risen Christ. So convinced were these men that their lives were transformed into committed followers willing to suffer and die for their belief. Liars make poor martyrs. Fourth, this theory runs opposite to everything we know about the disciples. As J.N.D. Anderson states, this would run totally contrary to all what we know. Proposition 5, the post-resurrection appearances. In 1 Corinthians 15, we have an early creedal statement. For I delivered unto you as first of importance that I also received. I just checked the time. I've got a rush. For I delivered unto you as first importance and received. If you look at 1 Corinthians 15, it's early historical source material. I could go on here. First, as shown above, a passage use, stylized wording and parallel structure to creedal formulae. In other words, if you look at the rabbis and the way they did oral tradition, this mimics the first century and shows that this is early historical source material. Fourth, the Aramaic term Cephas is used for Peter, indicating extremely early origin. New Testament scholar and skeptic Gerd Ludemann assigns this passage, this is an atheist, a very early date, stating that elements of the tradition are to be dated to the first 2 years of crucifixion of Jesus, not later than 3 years. The formation of the appearance of the tradition, what's all this say? Basically, when we use historical secular historians, We have the facts. We use the secular historian's methodology. It bears out the Christian faith as bearing those historical facts. The atheists don't have any facts, and therefore their theory of Jesus' resurrection and whatever it is doesn't bear the facts. We could go into everything else, but I'll leave it there.
All right. Thank you very much, Jason. At this time, DPR will have up to 20 minutes for his opening statements. Again, the topic of the debate is Christianity true? And if you have questions that you would like to propose to our debaters during the audience question time, you can send those to me, the Bible Thumping Wingnut, on Skype. And with that, DPR, you're up.
Thank you very much indeed, and thank you to all of those who are joining the debate. If I seem a little bit distracted, it's because I'm babysitting a little black furry thing who has been very troublesome, and one of the reasons that we started somewhat late is just before we were about to go live, it jumped up onto my desk and put its paw on the keyboard and did something that messed up my camera, so I had to reboot. So I apologize for that. I have to say, coming into this, and Jason and I appreciate the fact that there's a teacup in the way, and people have actually been commentating that you might want to remove the teacup so people can see you. It's a matter entirely for you. But I came in with into this debate with a few expectations, and wow, have I been disappointed. I thought at least there may be some attempt to be made to produce some sort of evidence in support of the proposition, and let's not lose sight of that proposition. The proposition is Christianity true? Jason, you have your microphone on. I'd be obliged, if I may ask, for you to mute yourself. Thank you. I thought that we may actually hear some attempt at evidence for the fact that Christianity is true. Now, let's not lose sight of this question. There are two ways in which you can interpret that question. The first is you can say, are there people, is Christianity true, that by which you could mean, are there people who believe in Christianity? Undoubtedly that is the case, and I think that this is one of the reasons that, well, I'm not sure it is, perhaps it is or perhaps it's not, that Jason became upset with Aaron Ra's comment that there is no evidence for Christianity. Of course, I don't actually accept Aaron's suggestion on the wider scope, that is to say, are there people who believe that Christianity is true? Undoubtedly they are, there are. But I think the more important question is, are the claims made by Christianity true? And that is what I'm going to seek to address. And in doing so, I think that Jason has put himself under an almost impossible task of showing that it is indeed true. And there are many reasons why. But I think if we're going to address the question, we first have to address what Christianity is. Now, Jason sort of like very briefly touched upon it, but what he didn't mention was, for example, that there are, I using someone else's figure, I can't guarantee that this is correct, but I've never heard a Christian argue otherwise. There are 30,000 denominations of Christianity. Now, that's a very important hurdle that he's got to get over. And I know from the videos he's made that I've watched that Jason considers that only his particular flavor of Christianity is the correct one. So he's got to say that the other 299,000 and whatever denominations of Christianity have got it wrong. wow. I won't go further at this stage, but it may be something that I come back to later on. So in preparation for this debate, I took time to search through a number of websites, Christian websites, that told me what the central tenets of Christianity were. And I think that I don't have the sites to hand, but I'm more than happy to provide them later if you want. But it seemed to me that the consensus was there are 10 or 12 central tenets to Christianity. And I'd be very interested to know whether Jason disagrees with any of these. I'll read them out as quickly as I can. Number one, Jesus Christ is the only way to eternal salvation with God and with God the Father. Two, we are saved by grace through faith, not by works. Three, Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Four, the incarnation of Jesus. Five, the bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ from the grave. Six, the ascension of Jesus Christ. Seven, the doctrine of the Trinity. Eight, the Holy Bible is inspired and the an infallible word of God. Nine, we are baptized with the Holy Spirit at the moment of salvation. Ten, renegation by the Holy Spirit. 11, the doctrine of hell. And 12, the second coming of Jesus Christ back to our earth. Now, those are, as I say, what I consider to be the core elements of anyone who claims to be a Christian. Let me give you an example about that, if I may. Richard Dawkins interviewed Richard Harries, the former Bishop of Oxford, now a member of the House of Lords, Lord Harries, during one of his television documentaries. During the course of that discussion, Richard Harries, who I think you would have to describe as being a fairly liberal member of the church, made various statements, so liberal that eventually Richard Dawkins actually invited him to say, well, look, you sound as if you're so liberal. What is the left for you to believe in that's necessary? The liberal tones that he had taken included statements about homosexuality. He's not someone that believes that homosexuals should be persecuted by the church or whatever. When asked what his core beliefs were, he didn't even include the virgin birth. What he did include was the resurrection. That was absolutely paramount. If you did not believe in the resurrection, then you were not. That was fundamental to his faith. Okay? You got no problem with that. I don't mind what religious people believe, and I find it always a giggle, an entertainment to see religious people arguing amongst themselves about who's got the right God and whatever. Which again is something that Jason has to struggle with here, I think, if he's going to prove that Christianity is true, because he's arguing, so far as I understand it, from an inerrancy point of view. That is to say that the Bible is the inerrant word of God. Fine, if he wants to do that, good luck to him. I think he will fail, and he'll fail in spades. You can't possibly. It's so full of misinformation. Information that is wrong and contradictions. But good luck to him. I'm not even asking him to do that at this stage. All I'm asking him to do is to provide evidence for one of those central tenets. Now, in my submission, I think that he has to provide evidence for all of them. And one of them won't do. I'll give you an example of what I mean. Let's say that Jason could prove, which I don't I don't accept that he can, but let's just say that Jason could prove that, I'm going to concede this point, Jesus, that person called Jesus, was resurrected. In my submission, he still has all his work cut out for him. Because the resurrection of Jesus by itself proves nothing at all. It does not prove any of the other 12 things that I've just read out, which I'm doing Jason a favor by just asking him to prove these 12 things rather than the fact that the Bible is inerrant, although that's actually one of them. But I'll excuse him that. If he can provide any evidence for any of these things, sorry, if you hear that noise in the background, it's this black little furry thing that I'm sure will probably be on the desk in front of us in a few moments' time. If he could prove any of those things, it would be helpful. But he's proved... quiet little one. He's not managed to prove any of them at all. What I was hoping for, as I said at the beginning, I was hoping for some sort of cat stuff. Look what I've got here now. I'm asked to be sort of concentrating on the point. I'm sorry. Look, I cut the cat. If he did provided anything that constituted evidence, then I would have addressed it. But I genuinely feel, and it comes as no surprise to me, so watch out. Because it's... Oh, Lordy, never get a cat. Look at you. You look so innocent now. Just throwing all my papers away. Okay, let me move on. I've been somewhat sidetracked, but let me move on to other problems that Jason has. Not only in my submission has he completely failed to provide any evidence for the claims that I think that he has to make, he's also in the position that he has got to somehow differentiate his position from other Christians, and also worse, he's got to... stop it, cat. Go on. Off. He's got to... Where was I? I think I was headed this way. What we know, one thing we know for certain, is that throughout history, every single civilization that we are aware of has created a god or gods. This seems to be an inerrant, banal nature of human being, of human beings, mankind. Jason, I strongly suspect, will not be able to provide me with any evidence of any civilization ever that has not created a god or gods. So he's then encumbered by another problem, that he's got to differentiate his god from literally the hundreds of thousands of gods that man has created. I have a horrible feeling that I may have made that point before, but oh no, it was in relation to denominations. Another problem that he has, let me take a slightly different track, if I may. The evidences that are normally provided by the religious to support the existence of their god or gods tend to fall into a number of categories. The first and the most obviously absurd is my book says it's true. Well, it was of interest. The very, very first statement that Jason came out with in his opening presentation was a quote from the Bible. I'm sorry, I don't know how to put this point across to the religious in a way that they understand, because clearly Jason doesn't seem to grasp this point. I don't know whether it's deliberate or whether he is delusional. It was a point that was expressed, I think, very well by Thunderfoot in his correlation with the Bible and Marvel Comics. Just because it is said in a book doesn't make it true. If that were the case, the series of Harry Potter books would be evidence of Platform 9 and 3 quarters, of Hogwarts, of Professor Dumbledore. What Jason has to do to make his point good, in my view, and because of he's relying on the Bible, he has to prove that the Bible is historically accurate. As best as he can, he always fails to do so. He tries desperately. I'll give him credit for his efforts. He refers to them as being early historic documents. He refers to them as eyewitness documents. I'm terribly sorry, Jason. Those claims are unjustified and untrue, and deep down, you know it. Then the next sort of argument you get is from personal experience. Oh, well, I've personally experienced this God. Oh, wow. Isn't that wonderful for you? Personal experience is, for me, so inconsequential, it doesn't register at all. We know that there are many people who have experienced many things which we know to be false. Alien abductions is one of the favorite ones, sightings of UFOs, experiences of ghosts, and whatever. You can have these personal experiences, but it doesn't, I'm sorry, it's the worst possible evidence that you can possibly provide in support of the argument. And of course, this again is something that Jason is going to have to struggle against. There are many, like him, who I'm sure have had some sort of personal experience with their God. But there are many that have got personal experiences with other gods. But he is determined. He is determined that it is his God that is right. And let's go back to the topic of this debate, that Christianity is true. Cat, stop it. Sorry. But let's say the argument was Islam is true. Cat, I'm trying to have an academic debate. Shh, for a second. I've only got 3 minutes to go, so I... Oh, God, I'm going to knock the table over. Okay, shush, shush. We also, through the studies made by, let's say, Andy Thompson, Professor Andy Thompson, I think is at, I can't remember which university he's at, but he's produced a book, Why Do We Believe in God or Gods, has shown that, again, it's something innate in us. And he also goes into great detail about explaining the evolutionary propensity for us to create gods. I realize that my time's running out. Wow, I've been talking for that long. Is there anything else? Oh, yes. I'll leave it on this, if I may. Many of us will recall, through the likes of YouTube, arguments that were presented. That's my telephone, Cat. Stop. Arguments were presented by the likes of Kent Hovind many years ago. I only became aware of them by virtue of YouTube and my involvement in YouTube. And in those days, the likes of Kent Hovind were coming out with scientific arguments, all of which have been debunked. You remember many of them. One of my favorite is carbon dating. Kent Hovind saying carbon dating doesn't work. If you've got a problem with that, go and watch some of Potholler's responses to it, including the one, there's no carbon in it. But these were amongst many, and the Grand Canyon was another one that he came up with. These have subsequently been parroted by the likes of his son, by the likes of Venom Fang X, by the likes of Nephilim Free. they don't use these arguments anymore. What they tend to use now is what I would describe loosely as philosophical arguments, such as the Kalam argument. And don't worry, I'm acutely aware of the clock. I will finish it within time. The reason that these arguments don't find any muster with me is because I've heard the same arguments, such as the Kalam, such as the presuppositionalism, and whatever. I've heard these exact same arguments being used by Muslims to justify the existence of Allah. Now, if you're going to use a presuppositionalist argument, then you have to explain why it is that your presuppositions lead you and can only lead anyone to your God and not another God. I think that's with 10 seconds left. It's actually quite good timing. Thank you very much. I hope my arguments have found favor.
Okay, thank you very much, DPR. And at this time, Jason has 10 minute time for a rebuttal of DPR's opening statement.
Okay, I want to thank DPR Jones. I really mean this. He is one of the most, he's much more intelligent than me. He's a very, very smart cookie. And in fact, if I had to debate somebody, I would not choose DPR Jones, because I really believe that he's one of the best debaters and thinkers out there. I really mean that, even though I've slated him. But someone who you love, just like a wife, you can have rows and you love at the same time. I really do love and respect DPR Jones, and I really admire him. And he's one of the great proponents of atheism out there. So I respect him, even though I give him a lot of stick. But what we've heard tonight is basically he gave a theological argument. Basically, he basically says that there are these various different views of Christianity, so therefore we're involved in theology, if he's going to say that. We're not involved in science. We're not involved in history, really. We're involved in a theological debate. I would never have thought that with DPR Jones. This guy is a smart guy. And if he's going to debate me, I would have thought he would have taken the fight to me with science, but he takes the fight to me with theology. And I'm happy to debate him on theology, because I'm a theologian. I've studied theology for over 20 years. The Bible says, God demonstrates his own love for us in this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us, Romans 5:8. Now, what the Bible teaches is the gospel. Paul says, cursed, listen, cursed is anyone who preaches not the gospel. What is the gospel? The gospel is anything, any biblical truth that when you believe it, you will be saved. So if you don't believe in hell and you say you're a Christian, you're going to go to hell, because there is a hell. If you don't believe Jesus is God in the flesh, you're going to go to hell, because God, Christ is God in the flesh. So the gospel is anything that you believe in Christ. That is the core of salvation. Jesus came to save us. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried. The third day he rose again from the dead according to the scriptures, and he appeared, 1 Corinthians 15:5, 6. In other words, as a guy who's been to a liberal seminary where I've sat under gay theologians and lesbian theologians, and a guy who's been to an evangelical seminary, I can tell you with authority that the gospel is Jesus Christ, King of kings, Lord of lords, he is the Savior. Now, you look at history, you look at the Apostles' Creed, one of the earliest creeds. It says that Jesus Christ is God. It says that to believe in Christ is what is salvation. So when you look at history, there is not this plurality that DPR Jones is saying on the basics. Even if you look at the Catholic Church, early on in its inception, it believed in Christ, the Savior, the Lord. Okay, the Catholic Church went astray because it got into tradition and man-centeredness, but the early Catholic Creed of the Apostolic Creed and the Nicene Creed believed in Christ. In other words, all this differentiation between Christians, most Christians who believe in Jesus Christ and they cross all denominations and believe in the Bible. So this separation that he says is questionable and it's not biblical. And if he wants to talk theology, then bring it on, DP. You've got to go to the Bible. That's not science, and you're a scientist, or you're into science. Anyhow, let's get on to the other stuff. Richard Dawkins and saying that that all these different religions, all the other religions can be, first of all, saying that all the there are all these other religions and this disproves Christianity. First of all, no, it doesn't. Clark Pinnock, I don't agree with all his theology, but a wonderful theologian in the 1980s, he changed and he went into process theology. I don't agree with it. He was influenced by Whitehead and all the rest. I don't agree with that. But he said some really good things in the 1980s. And we all change. We all make mistakes. I make mistakes. But anyhow, Clark Pinnock talks about that religious experience actually, throughout all the other religions, verifies Christianity. Acts chapter 17 talks about Paul when he comes to the philosophers. He says, you worship the unknown God. He was appealing to the fact that in human nature there is a belief in the transcendent. Even atheists believe in a transcendent. There are many atheists who believe in the numinous. So, looking at all the other religions, there is a general belief in the transcendent, and it actually points to the fact that there is a desire for people to believe in a God. If I have a hammer, what is the hammer for? It's to hit something. If I have a, if there is generally in all ages, in all times, religious belief, why is that the case? It's because there must be a fulfillment of that religious belief. And also, if you believe in evolution, then why? And all these atheists are saying, we've got to be rational, we've got to be rational, we've become more modern and rational. Then why hasn't evolution permeated out religion? It hasn't. Religion is proliferating around the world. So religion actually points to God. But secondly, we can differentiate between other religions. Christianity, my argument, is based in history. Jesus Christ dying and rising again is based on the preconditions of intelligibility. In other words, we cannot understand anything unless we have a condition of a personal God. We cannot understand morality unless we understand a personal God. Now, can we verify this in terms of other religions? Yes. Mormonism. It says that the Book of Mormon was created before the time of Jesus. Okay, how come in the Book of Mormon there are the King James Version? The King James Version is quoted extensively in the Book of Mormon. Obviously, it's not a book written prior to Jesus. In Islam, they say, in the Quran, it says that we're to turn to Mecca. Every mosque has a place where it points to Mecca. Archaeological evidence shows. The Quran says you've got to look to Mecca, okay? If you look at the archaeological evidence for the Quran, all the early mosques prior, after Muhammad, early on, all point to Petra, not Mecca. So as we look at the archaeological evidence, it does not verify Islam. So as we look at preconditions of intelligibility, as we look at the evidential information, it does not verify other religions. We could go to the Bhagavad Gita. When we come to philosophy, it is what could be described as pantheism. Everything is in everything. If that's the case, the law of non-contradiction does not apply. And we all know that we need the law of non-contradiction in order to argue our case. So the Bhagavad Gita does not actually verify logic. So we can say that religions can be shown to be wrong, but religion also shows the transcendence desire of man for God. And Christianity fulfills that perfectly. In Jesus Christ, I am the way, the truth, and the life. We could go on. He talks about Dawkins and using this argument my friends. There's so much I wanted to bring in, but I've got to deal with his objections, intellectually honest. He goes on about using Dawkins and about what is it now? My mind's gone. What is it now? Altruism, using, you know, religion. That there are these. What am I trying to say? He's using Dawkins and using psychological arguments for religion. P. Mayers, who is an atheist, says these kind of arguments are not worth their salt because psychological arguments that you can use are quite relative, really. And an intellectual like DPRjones should not be using that kind of stuff, really, unless he actually can substantiate. He quoted a professor, but he never gives us the details. If he's going to present something, give us the details, give us the citations, give us the scholarly equipment to go and check it out. And I've got 1:40. I'll leave that there. I've not dealt with all of his things, but I've dealt with some. Anyhow, on the resurrection, first of all, he didn't deal with the law of non-contradiction. He didn't deal with absolute morality. If he's going to argue against me, he's got to deal with epistemology. Oh, presuppositions. Presuppositions is absolutely vital. All reasoning is circular. My argument is not based on presuppositions. It's partly based on presuppositions, but if you notice, my epistemology is varied and rich. Have you noticed something? We haven't heard anything about DPRjones' epistemology. Have you heard that? We did not hear anything about his epistemology. But my epistemology is rich and varied. A priori, a nuanced understanding of Kant and Hume throughout the history of epistemology. And by the way, those who are philosophy students, I had no way in fully understand epistemology. It is beyond the average person, and I'm just an average person. So I don't want to give you the impression that I'm an expert at it. But let me tell you this, DPRjones gave us no epistemology. I give you a rich and varied, nuanced epistemology. That which uses Kant, that which uses Hume, and that which uses presuppositions and empiricism. So I could go on. I want to talk about so much, but I have to defer to DPRjones. Take care, okay? I'll leave it there.
DPR, now you have 10 minutes to rebut Jason Burns' opening statement.
Certainly, and thank you very much. I was told that I didn't provide my sources. It's here. It's a book by J. Anderson Thompson, J-R-M-D, with Claire, I'm going to pronounce that wrong, Ricky, so I'll just say with Claire, Why We Believe in God or Gods. This is a book that I was referring to. He is a professor of psychology at Virginia University in America. The book is readily available on the internet, and I would strongly encourage anyone who may be interested to purchase it. It probably takes you a couple of hours to read it. It explains the psychology behind why, from an evolutionary perspective and a psychological perspective, why mankind has the ability to create gods. So, and anything that I have said that people do not believe that I have referenced appropriately, when this video is subsequently posted, I will provide whatever references you like. I have deliberately not used references for the very reason that Aaron, when he wanted to have a discussion with Jason, said it's got to be done in writing, because if you're going to start throwing out references, I want to go and check them. I want to go and see what they say. Now, going back to my preliminary point, I was expecting some sort of evidence. And sorry, Jason, I can hear you. Would you mind muting your microphone?
Oh, sorry.
Thank you. And what I find interesting is in his rebuttal, he criticizes me for a number of things, some of which I will pick up on. But you will also see that he keeps on quoting the Bible. And I don't know how I can get across to him or other Christians who believe that the Bible is the inerrant word of God. I'm sorry, you can't quote the Bible to prove the Bible. It's nonsensical. Why you can't grasp that is beyond me. But for that reason, I think it is so shallow when you said, oh yeah, but God exists, because look in the Bible, it says God exists. Or look in the Bible, because it says this. Or, you know, the fool, what was it, the fool in his heart will say, no, God exists. I'm supposed to be persuaded and convinced by this risible level of evidence. And what I find odd. I'll come back to the issue of evidence, but what I find absolutely fantastic is that you say that all of Islam is incorrect, because if you look at the original transcripts of the Quran. The things are pointing in the wrong direction. They're pointing not to Mecca, but to somewhere else. Wow. Just wow. And you, I mean, what's the classic expression? You don't see you see the bit of dust in the other person's eye without appreciating the plank in your own. Have you ever really looked at the Bible and seen how many inaccuracies, inconsistencies, and false statements? So if you're going to write off the entirety of Islam on the basis that it's got one or two things wrong in its holy book, then you've got to reject your own. It is an utterly unpersuasive argument. But let's get back to evidence. You see, what I find interesting is this. I think that if I was in court, I wouldn't have a problem with Jason being on the jury because, excuse me, because I think that he's perfectly capable of taking in evidence, assessing evidence, weighing it up, applying the appropriate weight to that evidence. But when it comes to religion, he's totally blinkered, and the ordinary expectations and appreciation of evidence that he adopts throughout his daily life, for some reason, when it comes to religion, disappear. And I suspect I know exactly what that is. It's because his presupposition, and he keeps on going on about presupposition, which is of no surprise to me at all, because I think it's really that religion's last bastion, the last bastion of scoundrels, if I may say so, is that these sort of like philosophical arguments are all they're left with. There is a wonderful speech delivered by A.C. Grayling called Setting Prometheus Free. It's widely available on the internet, and my only criticism about it is that it's exactly the same, almost word for word. But he does it very well, without notes, which for a 45-minute speech I think is fairly impressive. But in it, he describes the, I don't know what's the best word to describe it, the increasing distance that we have from the genies and spirits and whatever. And I have to say that he's absolutely correct in what he's saying. I can find no fault in it at all. That is to say, you know, when we're going back several thousand years now, but people used to believe that genies lived in the woods and in the trees and whatever. But as our understanding grew, so did the distance between us and the gods. And rather than living in the woods around us, they became gods that lived on mountaintops. And then we climbed the mountains and we found there were no gods there. I mean, mountaintops lived, I mean, it's not that long ago. The religions of the Greeks and whatever, they had them on top of mountains. But then, as I say, we climbed to the top of mountains and found the gods weren't there. So they elevated themselves into the firmament. And then we started examining the firmament, and they disappeared from that as well. And now, despite the fact that only 2,000 years ago, God actually made him, to be fair, 6,000 years ago, correct myself, God made himself visible quite frequently. He appears in the Garden of Eden, shouting out to Adam, you know, where are you? He appears subsequently. He obviously appears to Moses and whatever. But his appearances become more and more distant. He then starts appearing in odd sorts of ways. He appears as a burning bush. And then he's disappeared. into the firmament and beyond. So now, one may rightly say, it's almost as if he never existed at all. Now, I want to finish with this, if I may. I realize I've got 90 seconds or so left. I want to finish with this. I want to make it abundantly clear that the position I hold is one based on evidence. If there was evidence that I thought was persuasive, well, in fact, any evidence, but I suspect it would have to be cogent and persuasive at the very least, and not contradicted by other evidence, then I would have absolutely no problem at all in believing in a God. I am frequently criticized, as most atheists are, oh, well, you just don't want to believe, or you know that you believe, or whatever. No, that's not the truth. And certainly the you don't want to believe because you want to carry on your sinful way. I'm sorry, most of the people I know who are atheists are the most kind, generous, and wonderful people who are, like myself, open to persuasion, but that persuasion is going to have to be based on evidence. Anyway, let's go back to the very core of what we're talking about now. Is Christianity true? Give me evidence, and I'm sure I would believe it was true. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, DPR. At this time, Jason Burns has 10 minutes for cross-examination.
Do you want to take a break, Jason? Are you happy to carry on?
I'm happy to carry on, DP.
Okay, thank you.
You say that you want to base everything in evidence. Is that correct?
Sorry, I muted myself. Yes, that is correct.
Okay. Biogenesis. What evidence have you got for that?
I think you mean abiogenesis.
Abiogenesis. What evidence do you have?
The fact that life is here.
How can non-life become life, and what is the scientific evidence for that?
I think that's an interesting question, and let me address it as best I can. It is probably the greatest unknown that science has. Well, that's putting it too far. There are various theories about how life could have developed. I'm the wrong person to ask about it, but I know that there are people who you could address if you wanted to, who will tell you about. And I'd suggest, amongst other things, videos made by Pothole at 54, The Origins. I'm going to get the title wrong. I apologize. The Origins of, it's not the, the History of Life. It'll come to me. But I'd look at that. The idea that science has got absolutely no idea about it whatsoever would be a fallacious and inaccurate statement to make. There are various theories, but I'm quite happy to put my hands up to say I don't know, and I'm not entirely sure that science or the body of science would be content in saying we've got a totally acceptable theory. I think it's one of those things that scientists are working on. But I have to say this, if I may. The idea that science does not, at the moment, have answers to everything does not mean that it will not have answers to things in due course. If you took that view, it would be a ridiculous view, would it not? If you look at how science and technology and understanding and knowledge has increased within your lifetime, Jason, to try and make a point out of the fact that we don't know something is, unfortunately, in my regard, utterly redundant.
Okay. The Miller experiment, which is trying to prove that life came from non-life, which was in the 50s, is in textbooks today. Dr. Wells says about this, Wells says, just get the quote. He says, granted, he said, about life coming from non-life, but my point remains the same. The problem of assembling the right parts in the right way at the right time and at the right place while keeping out and wrong material is simply insurmountable. Frankly, the idea that we're on the verge of explaining the origin of life naturalistically is just silly to me, and many other prominent scientists as well. But the point is, you said that you only believe in evidence, and you have no evidence whatsoever to verify that life came from non-life, and so therefore you're living by faith, thereby contradicting what you're saying. The second point that I want to say...
Well, can I address that first?
No, I've not asked the question. I'm just going to go on to my next question. Is, we talked about the issue concerning morality, absolute morality. Can I ask a question? Do you believe there is an absolute morality or not?
No, I do not.
Okay. You do not believe there's an absolute morality?
No.
Correct?
Correct.
Okay. Then why do you always object against the morality of Christians?
I don't.
You don't?
No.
Okay, well, I would ask folks to go and watch The Magic Sandwich Show, and they will find out that DPRjones is quite vocal.
If you would like to be more specific, then please
You've denounced me, you've denounced Christians against homosexuality. So obviously what you're saying is, and what you're saying is, that there is no absolute morality. So your denunciation is based on some kind of subjective opinion. Again, you say that you say that your position is based on evidence. And if you're saying that morality is relative, then I can't understand where you're coming from about denouncing other people.
Let me make it clear. I'm sorry.
I'm not asking the question. I'll ask you the question. I want to ask the question, do you believe in evolution?
Yes.
Do you believe that we have free will?
I'm not sure about that question. I struggle with it. I used to think that we have had. I'm not certain about it. I'm not sure that we do.
Okay, I finished my question. I finished my question. You said that you believe in evidence, and you have no evidence to substantiate morals. You have no evidence to substantiate free will. And you have no evidence to substantiate there is or problem. I rest my case. Over to UDP.
Well, you don't rest your case. You asked me a number of questions which you haven't allowed me to answer. But if I may, I will do so as best as I can. The fact that light could come from...
I have not asked... DP, the point is I've asked you questions and you are to respond. And then when I finish my questions...
I'm trying to respond.
That's the end. That's the end. If you want to go on, that's not debate format. I've asked my questions, you've responded, that's the end. If you want to continue, then I'll ask more questions.
Well, Jason, you haven't allowed me to respond to the questions that you asked.
I gave you ample opportunity. But go ahead, you're changing the debate format, but go ahead.
Oh, you still have 3 minutes and 21 seconds.
Yeah, but it's my prerogative. When I've asked my question, you respond. It's my prerogative to finish.
Jason, I think the viewers... Sorry.
Over to the moderator. Sorry.
Jason, do you have any questions that DPR did not answer that you would like him to answer at this time?
No, he's answered them perfectly well. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Well, I suppose we will move on and... As we move to DPR's cross-examination, I just want to say in about 15 minutes, we're hoping to have questions from the audience. Please send those to me on Skype, the Bible Thump and Wingnut. That is my Skype name, handle, whatever you want to call it. And so far, I only have one question, and there has been up to 69 people watching. So, viewers, if you want to have your questions read here, there's a good chance if you submit a question, it will be asked to our participants. With that said, DPR, 10 minutes for a cross-examination of Jason Byrne's position.
Thank you very much. Jason, I know others will judge this, and you will, I have no doubt, come to a contrary view. I do not believe, this is the question I'm putting to you, I do not believe that you have provided any evidence in support of the proposition. If you had an opportunity to give just your best point, what do you think your best point is?
My best point is that if we're going to use reason and argument, logic is the law of non-contradiction is the basis of reason. We cannot object or affirm unless we use the law of non-contradiction. If that law of non-contradiction is based in the material, i.e. if the law of non-contradiction is material, and you are into scientism, that is all that there is of science and the material, then the law of non-contradiction cannot stand. You cannot object to me using the law of non-contradiction, because the material changes. And if the material changes, then logic changes. You need, for preconditions of intelligibility, you need to posit a transcendent understanding of logic. That is, logic cannot be smelt, it cannot be weighed, and it is outside, it is not contingent upon the material. And this, so therefore, you need to posit a transcendent understanding of logic in order to use the law of non-contradiction. And the law of non-contradiction is that A cannot be B in the same context. That law is intentional. That is to say, it gives us information and understanding about certain things. And intention implies personality, which implies the existence of God.
Well, it's interesting you say that. Let me have a follow-up question, if I may. If you say the law of non-contradiction is A cannot be not A, then can you explain to me how Jesus can be a man and also at the same time part of a Trinity and not a man, all of which comes from your good book? That is a breach of the law of non-contradiction, is it not?
The law of non-contradiction is that A cannot be B in the same context. Yeah. Well, if God is not in the same context as God, he is in relation to human nature, and human nature is in relation to God. So the law of non-contradiction still applies. We know what God is, and we know what human nature is. Then we have also the issue of the infinite and the finite. We need the law of non-contradiction to understand the infinite. That is, infinite is not finite, and finite is not infinite. So we still need the law of non-contradiction to understand those things. But our limitations of human knowledge, that is, we are limited in our understanding of knowledge, we cannot understand the infinite, and that's where the problem is. The problem is not with the law of non-contradiction.
I wonder why you raise it then, but let's move on. I want to move on to a slightly different issue, if I may. Could you describe for me, as best you can, the qualities and nature of the God that you believe in?
Qualities of nature, yeah?
No, the quality and nature of the God that you believe in. You're not looking at the Bible, are you?
Yeah, of course I am, mate. You have your circular reasoning and I have mine, bro. My quality of my God is John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning. In other words, there is God is relational. And then secondly, this is a very important issue. Verse 14, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. God is not only relational, he's also sacrificial. He has come down to share his love for humanity.
Do you have a personal relationship with your God?
I do, bro.
Do you hear the voice of God?
I do. In the Word of
God.
If
that voice told you to kill your aunt, would you do it?
No, because it's got
Why not?
Because it's got a cord. Because the referential point for a Christian is the cross.
That is the center of a Christian faith, that Jesus Christ died on the cross, DP. He sacrificed himself for God's soul of the world, that he gave his only begotten son. It was a sacrificial love. So if a voice says to me, go and kill someone, I know that Christ gave his life, sacrificed his life. And in 1 John it talks about, if you do not love your brother, then you're not a true Christian. So in other words, the cross is the central loci of all ethics for a Christian. And the cross is sacrificial love. So any voice that comes to me and tells me to do something, I filter it through the cross of Christ, which is historically verified as one of the most well-attested historical facts, says Dominic Crossan, a skeptic.
You've just said that you hear the voice of God. Yes or no?
I hear the voice of God in context of the Word of God.
I have absolutely no understanding of what that white noise means.
Sorry, DP.
Could you explain what on earth you mean? Do you hear the voice of God, yes or no?
A Christian, a true Christian, is, it says, Paul talks about that the Word of God is God-breathed. So for a Christian, the Word of God and the Holy Spirit work together. Jesus says that we worship God in spirit, notice, spirit and in truth. Truth. Truth is historical in Christ. Okay? So when I hear the Word of God, when I hear God's voice, it's filtered through that hermeneutic of historical conjecture and verifiability in the historical Christ. If anything goes against the historical Christ, then I am going to make sure that I filter it in him.
So you don't hear the Word of God. You hear the Word of God only through your filter, which is subjective, yes?
I hear the Word of God, but I test when I have an experience. My experience, a Mormon could say they experience something. But the Book of Mormon, there is no evidence for the Book of Mormon.
I'm not asking about that, Jason.
But I'm explaining to you my experience. When I experience God, it's always under the understanding that it's checked with objective Word of God in history. I can't say that I experience something without the objectivity. If I've got no objectivity, it's just my personal experience. So yes, I hear the Word of God, but it cannot be just experience. It has to be somewhere. There's got to be some objectivity somewhere. Otherwise, I'm a mystic, and I'm not a mystic. I am a born-again believer. I believe in the gospel. The gospel is Jesus died and rose again, verified historically.
Well, it's not, is it? And let's take my last couple of minutes dealing with this issue. You say it's historically verified. You spent the best part of 9 months conjuring up what you described initially as a world-class academic paper, which you subsequently described as lecture notes or perhaps a footnote. Who knows? But this was going to be evidence of the resurrection. And yet, in the conclusion of whatever you want to call it, I would have a slightly different name, but whatever you want to call it, in the conclusion, you accept that you provide no evidence whatsoever of the resurrection. Yes?
I don't know what you mean, DP. You need to clarify that.
Oh, I'm terribly sorry. Let me clarify.
Yeah.
You said that you would produce a paper which would give evidence of the resurrection. 9 months afterwards, you produced something, however you want to describe it, I'm not too concerned, in which, in your own conclusion, you accept that you do not give evidence of the resurrection. Yes?
I can't remember, DP, but I think that in terms of epistemology, I gave quality evidence in historical and in what good scholarship, and that's the best that I can do. That I made the differentiation between ontological and functional epistemology in terms of the resurrection. So if you want to get into the nuances, I'm happy. I did not give causal evidence, but I gave evidence for the basic facts of Jesus' death and resurrection. If you want me to give causal evidence, that's a different matter, and we can get. I'll get into that later on. I'll give you that. Okay.
I think I'm done.
Sorry about that. Didn't know that would make such a loud noise. Thank you, guys. That was very interesting. That was obviously, as we all know, that's the most one of the most interesting parts of the debate is when we cross-examine and have that interaction. At this time, I'm going to have about 5 or 6 minute break. I've got one question come through Skype for DPR and one question for Jason Burns. We're going to take just a 5 minute break. We'll come back and take some time to address those questions and any other questions that may come in the next 5 minutes. And that will be followed by 10 minutes of closing statements by each of our debaters.
Yeah, so, do you just want to reiterate the Skype address that they need to send questions into?
Excellent. Bible Thumping Wingnut. If you do a search for the Bible Thumping Wingnut, you're going to come up with a graphic. That's the picture that I have on my Skype, so that's how you know you're sending it to the right person. So anybody got questions? We've still got over about 65 viewers. Send those questions, and in about 5 minutes, we will be right back.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
goodness we got rid of that awful music.
Oh, come on, it wasn't that bad.
It was dreadful.
Dreadful.
Okay, so what's the next step we're on to? Is it question time?
Yes.
Okay.
We have a very long question for you, sir, which has multiple questions in it. And then I've
Do you want to give me one at a time?
Well, it's also it's also a statement. tell you what I'll do, DPR. I'm going to send you it on Skype, and then I'll read it. Let me see. There we go. There you go.
Oh, Lord, it is quite long, isn't it? Yes, you read it out, then.
Yes, I'll read it. So we'll ask DPR his question, and then allow him to answer. Here we go. Hey, DPR. This is Thick Shades, your old nightmare. Please note, DPR, any evidence of God will not save you. Only Jesus Christ will. Believe on Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. Now, I believe God is omnipotent, meaning having unlimited power. Do you think God would have any need to create any other gods? If yes, why would omnipotent God have any need to create any other gods? If no, don't you then agree that there's only one true God? Don't you think this one true omnipotent God is powerful enough to become a mere human, i.e. God in the flesh, i.e. Jesus Christ? If yes, Jesus Christ is God. If no, are you saying God is not even omnipotent enough to resurrect himself?
I don't want to sound trite when I say this, but the question is based on a premise which I don't accept. So for me to answer it would be a nonsense. I do not accept there is such a thing as a God. So to talk about his qualities would be utterly absurd. I don't know how further I can go. I could, if you want, I suppose, respond in this way. If the God that is described in the Bible exists and is all-loving and all-powerful, then I believe that the Christians are put in an even more difficult position than they were already. By having to justify acts of evil and natural disaster. Either you're saying your God is omnipotent and can control natural disasters, or he is not. If you accept that he's not, then he isn't the God that is described in the Bible. If you accept that he is, then why does he allow such things to happen when he could put a stop to it? Why does he allow small children to die of cancer, suffering for 18 months of their two-year life? Why does your God allow these things? And I know that I'm probably going to get a response from Jason, and it's going to be hideous and absurd. But if Jason does respond to this question, I would invite everyone that is watching to listen very carefully to the justification that is made for an all-powerful, all-loving God to allow this to happen. Because you will, if you listen clearly, you'll find it absurd and abhorrent.
Okay, myself, I'm unfamiliar during question time from the audience how we allow Jason. Do you want to interact with that? I have my own opinion, but it's completely irrelevant as a moderator.
But if Jason doesn't want to respond, I'm more than happy to listen to your response, because I'm terribly sorry to say I think I will find it as abhorrent and as objectionable as any response that Jason is minded to give. But it's up to Jason. I don't mind you giving your tuppence worth, so to speak.
Jason, if you're speaking, your microphone is muted.
First of all, DPRjones used the law of non-contradiction. He's not given us any philosophical justification for that. Secondly, he's using, he said that morality is subjective. So why is he making an objective statement about morality? He's not proved that. And thirdly, a Christian believes the problem of evil ultimately rests in the cross. There, evil was dealt with in Jesus dying on the cross. The way reason came in is God allowed human beings to have free will. They messed up, and then God solved it by coming down and dying at the cross. He uses an argument about children suffering. That's an emotive argument. He's not based his argument on any scientific evidence. Don't forget, DPRjones is a scientist. That Magic Sandwich Show is about science. And you cannot even begin to talk about morality or justify it objectively. You need the Christian position to talk about objective morality. And he's not verified that, so his question is a non-question.
It wasn't my question. I was just giving you the opportunity to answer someone else's question.
Well, I've stated my case, so.
Well, you haven't answered the question.
I have answered the question. I answered it very clearly.
Okay. So next question.
I have a question for Jason. This is from Bradley on Skype. A question for Jason. Without human-made language, how would he go about providing a God... Excuse me. Without human-made language, how would you, Jason, go about proving a God exists?
Without human language...
Without human-made language.
Without human-made language, how would I go about proving God exists? Well, language presupposes personality, so you need language for personality. Personality cannot come from nature. The personhood, you have this problem about the is-ought. That is, nature does not tell you what an ought is. What that means is there is no personhood. Personhood means free choice. So in order to use language, you need personhood, free agents. Free agents cannot come from nature, and so you need a transcendent understanding of morality. So in other words, in order to use language, you need a transcendental epistemology. So his question doesn't disprove Christianity, it actually proves Christianity. In other words, I would use language because language is justified in a transcendental sense, epistemologically, in God. Language presupposes personhood. Okay.
DPR, did you want to interact on that question with Jason?
I don't think there's anything that I can usefully add. Say for one thing, perhaps, if I may. I know that Jason brings with him enormous... scholarship. He has frequently referred to spending over 10 years, I think it is, studying theology. He may bring that with him, but unfortunately I struggle to see that he's bringing any coherent argument with him, and he's certainly not producing any evidence. But perhaps that is something that I'll return to, and perhaps is better for the closing arguments.
Another question for Jason, coming from Skype, of course, from Don Rozek. Jason, the question is, how can a non-Christian tell the difference between a presupposition and a delusional belief?
There's two ways of knowing. One is justified belief in terms of evidence, and the issue is quality of evidence. But when we look at presuppositions, then the way to know whether one presupposition is correct against another is what Greg Banson would call internal critique. So what we do is we look at the presupposition, for example, reason, logic, and we do an internal critique of the atheist and an internal critique of our own position. And the one that is consistent is the one that we go for.
So, for example, the atheist position is that everything came by chance. They say that it isn't, but it is. Everything came about by chance. Well, how can logic, that which is logical, come from that which is not logical? Our presupposition, internal critique, is we presume a God of logic who is reasonable. And so, therefore, we have a transcendent understanding that logic is based in God, and it's consistent. Our presupposition is consistent. So we look at Greg Banton will talk about internal critique. I must say that there's many, many nuances in epistemology. Those who are students in philosophy will know that it's a can of worms, and I'm only just beginning to understand it. But that's how we do it: internal critique.
Okay, we have one more question that I've received.
Can I just deal with that briefly, if I may? Jason, I don't think for the first time has referred to evolution as a chance event. Some aspects of it are chance, but to argue that evolution is chance is, again, I'm terribly sorry to say, is incorrect.
Could I come back on that, because he's, or should I keep quiet?
No, you may.
I'm talking about the beginning of history, the beginning of everything.
Well, okay? Which is it?
There's a difference. Evolution is about natural selection and mutations. I'm on about the beginning of history. There's a difference. The beginning of history, when matter came into existence, that's different from evolution. You should know that of all people, DP.
Yes, I'm glad that you clarified that issue. So you're saying that the origins of the universe, we argue, came about by chance.
Well, as Dawkins said, you've only got two conclusions.
Well, no, I'm not interested in what Dawkins says. Why don't you ask me what I think, seeing as it's you and I that are discussing?
Well, tell us then, DP.
It's an unknown.
Unknown, all right. So, nothing, that which is nothing, became something, and you are a materialist. Are you a materialist, DP?
I'm terribly sorry, Jason. Let me spell this out again, if I may. It is an unknown. There are various theories and hypotheses about how it may have happened, but it remains an unknown. So you cannot, given the fact that I have just told you that it is unknown, you can't turn around to me and say, oh, well, you're saying that nothing came out of nothing. It is an unknown. What about that? Do you not understand?
Okay, DP, that would be fine if you weren't into... All that there is the material, my friend. If you are people on the Magic Sandwich Show banging on about science, 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 and the material in the material, then you've got to be called out on the justification of your presupposition. It does not fit.
I'm sorry, Jason, you asked me a question. Allow me to address it, if I may. You've made a point. Let me address it, if I may. It may clarify what your next point is. I've got no problem with addressing your point.
Let me address that point, if I may. Let me step in. We are now on a topic of the start of the universe. I'm going to allow DPR a minute or two at most to make a statement, and then Jason, 1 minute statement. And then I've got one more question from Skype, and then we will move to our closing statements. So go ahead, DPR, uninterrupted, for up to 2 minutes.
Oh, I'll only take a minute, I think. But thank you very much for your moderation. I think it's unfair of you, and also false of you, to say that anyone on the Magic Sandwich Show has ever made any statement of certainty about how the universe began. And I would challenge you to find anyone who has ever appeared on the Magic Sandwich Show who has made such a statement. The fact is that because something is unknown does not mean that you can say, oh, well, you're saying this happened and this happened. No, we're not saying that. We're speculating, perhaps to a degree. We're embracing certain hypotheses and theories, perhaps. But I'm sorry, Jason, you are utterly wrong if you say that anyone on the Magic Sandwich Show knows what happened. And do not say otherwise, please. Thank you.
Okay, can I finish?
Yep, Jason, up to a minute, please.
Yeah, you're straw manning the DP. I am not saying that the Magic Sandwich Show is saying how the beginning of time, how the beginning of matter happened. I am not saying that. So you're straw manning. What I am saying is you're the person who says you're working on evidence. So I'm working on evidence. The evidence that I get from the Magic Sandwich Show is that not all of you, but most of you, are into science and the material. So I'm working on that basis. If all that there is that you believe at the present time is the material is not sufficient cause to sustain itself eternally. If that's the case, and the material is not intentional, then you can only conclude that the material has come from what can only be described as what I'm saying is the material has not within itself the sufficient grounds for its causality. So I'm working off that, my friend, and from that, that is chance. If there's no intentionality, it's chance. So I'm working off.
I think what you ought to do is look up the definition of straw man, because what you have just done, rather than what I did, you have just created a straw man.
Okay.
You've responded.
Guys, we can save whatever comments you have for our closing, your closing statements, if you want to address any more of that. I have one more question, and although we only had four questions from Skype, at least we were able to address all of them. This question, again, is for Jason, and Jason, I sent it to you on Skype because just like the question for DPRjones, it was a lengthy one. So, Jason, if you want to read it on your Skype as I'm reading it to our audience, that may help you follow along. This is from Hogtie Champ, and he says he has a question for Jason. Why do Christians claim special ownership or understanding for principles such as the law of non-contradiction, even when those Christians can't show even a rudimentary understanding of such principles? Jason's description of principles of the principle shows a complete lack of understanding. Is it a fallacy to point out that the Christian's lack of understanding means that Christians don't have special knowledge of the underpinnings? Jason, would you like to answer that question?
Yeah, to me it seems a lot of what he's saying is ad hominem attacks on Christians. Look, epistemology is a big subject. I only know a little bit of it. Recently I just read 100 pages on the history of epistemology. So who's mastered epistemology? It's a big subject. So no, Christians haven't got a master's of epistemology. We're just trying to look at it honestly and intellectually honest and look at our presuppositions and law of non-contradiction, the history of philosophy recently, and the history of the modernist project. We have these high priests of materialism. They've ditched the rationalism, not all atheists, but a lot of them have ditched the rationalism, and that's the Kantian rationalism, and moved into empiricism. And they're telling us all that we've got to accept this. And basically, presuppositionalism is a challenge to empiricism. It's saying that not all that we know is based purely on empiricism. And that's all we're doing, and also that being honest about reason is circular. All knowledge ultimately is circular. I mean, you can't get away from that. Now, DPRjones and the atheists can play their game and say, well, we're not going to play with you because we're empiricists, and the presuppositionalists can say, we're not going to play with you, just like Gordon Clark would say, we're presuppositionalists. But at the end of the day, this is a big subject, and it's worthy of understanding, and the Christian has a consistency in their presupposition about the law of non-contradiction, and I don't think the atheists have. But there has to be a humility there as well. I'm only learning.
All right, fair enough. At this time, we're going to move to our closing statements. Up to 10 minutes for DPRjones.
Oh, well, thank you. And thank you to all those who have joined in and have watched live, and also to those who have who are watching subsequently. Let's not forget what the proposition was that we were discussing. Is Christianity true? As I said earlier, I wasn't expecting a great deal, but I have to say that I'm somewhat disappointed in the... Jason, would you please mute your microphone? Thank you. I was disappointed in what I had to deal with. I'm more than happy to, if anyone thinks that I didn't deal with any argument that was raised. There were certainly some that I consider I was not in a position to address, even though I wanted to do so. But going back to where we started from, what is Christianity? Without a definition of Christianity, you cannot consider whether Christianity is true. The 12 points that I won't labour again are, I think, the central tenets of all of the 30,000 plus denominations of Christianity. Not one of them, not one, have we heard any evidence to support it, save from occasional quotes from the Bible. And Jason is very fond of the expression circular reasoning. That is the absolute accolade of circular reasoning, using the Bible to prove the Bible. I don't believe that he doesn't get that. I really don't. I just think some sort of like compartmentalization that's going on in his head when it comes to Christianity. As I said before, we've heard arguments, and I have to let me backtrack a little bit if I may. If Jason had been able to prove that Christianity is true, then he would have been able to do something that no one has been able to do for 2,000 years. So I think it was brave of him to take on the challenge. And again, I want to express that I and every single atheist that I know does not disbelieve Christianity because we don't want to and we want to live a sinful life. That is an incredibly offensive message, and one which I take great umbrage with. Those atheists I know are the most moral, kind, understanding, and generous people I've ever come across. I'm not saying that theists do not have that capacity, but I think one of the things that separates some theists, and I choose my words carefully here, some theists and some atheists, is a bigotry that comes with theism. And I don't tar all theists with this brush, because a lot of them have dropped the more appalling and disgusting segments of the Bible. But there are some theists who do still harbor bigotry, hatred, and discrimination based on their belief in their good book. And unfortunately, I tar Jason with that brush, in particular with regard to his views on homosexuality. And I don't care how he tries to explain away, oh, we love the sinner but not the sin. It's white noise to me. It is bigotry, it is discrimination, it is hatred, and it should be seen and exposed as such. I cannot disprove Christianity. I only have got 5 minutes, okay. I can't disprove Christianity. I can't disprove Islam. I can't disprove a teapot orbiting around the sun. I can't help myself. I've got to make some comment on it. I seem to have been talking to a teacup for the last couple of hours, and I may well have been, given the amount of sense and coherence that has come from Jason. I have no doubt whatsoever that in the course of the next few days, Jason will post 20 or more videos explaining exactly how and why he won this debate. I'll let him do so. I'm not that bothered about it. I appreciate the fact that he actually turned up for this one. But I'll leave it to the audience to determine whether there was a winner or a loser. I don't actually consider this a matter of winning or losing. What I think this is, if there's anything constructive to come out of it, it is, I think, this. Given the proposition, given the amount of time that Jason had to support the proposition, he, like every single theist for 2 millennia before him, has failed to provide any cogent, persuasive evidence that Christianity is true. And I go back, let me just clarify again, I go back to the first point I made. If you define Christianity as those who believe it, yes, Christianity is true. But that's not how Jason is defining it. Jason is basically telling you that the God of the Bible, the Christ figure that is displayed in the Bible, is true. What evidence does he have? None. Absolutely none. Outside his own book. And even that book is contradictory and contains inconsistencies. The evidence that he has supplied, well, I'm not sure he's actually supplied any evidence at all to justify that we should take that book seriously. None. And I'd say he was taking on a tall order in trying to do so. If it was the case that such evidence was available, it would have come out over the last 2,000 years. I've got 2 minutes left, so I'll conclude with this. The presuppositional sort of argument, the philosophical type of argument, the arguments about logic and the law of non-contradiction, I think this exposes how desperate the theists are to try and justify their belief. And I have to say also that I think it's an absolute embarrassment. This is as good as it gets. Every single philosophical argument they try and use can be used by any other religion to reach opposingly diametric conclusions. And if an argument can be used that produces such divergent conclusions, then it's not an argument that should be taken seriously. It can be dismissed. You don't have to address it. If you hear the likes of Hamza Sortsis using the presuppositional argument or the Kalam argument, both of which I've seen him use, to reach the conclusion that Allah exists, and the likes of Jason and William Lane Craig and others have used it to prove that Yahweh exists. As I say, diametrically opposed, incompatible conclusions, you can dismiss that argument. I'm running very short of time. I suppose I'll finish with the last 20 seconds or so that I have by thanking everyone again. And thank you to Jason and also to Bible Thumping Wingnut for being, I have to say, an excellent moderator, and I'll leave it there. But please, as I say, if you're watching this subsequently, express your views in the description. Thank you very much.
Thank you, DPR. With that, Jason, please move your wonderful teacup and give us your 10-minute closing statement.
Okay. I just want to say that, you know, I everyone knows that I've struggled. I struggle, and I do make mistakes, and sometimes I can fail and in my attitudes and things like that, and I'm sorry for that, and I want to grow, and I want to be a better person, and I hope that you bear with me and teach me and guide me, but the Lord will forgive me, and that the Lord will help me. The other thing is, I want to say to DPRjones, thank you. He saved my biscuit. He was very kind to debate me. I don't deserve his debate. I really regard him as one of the brightest buttons around, and if I had a choice of debating Thunderfoot or him, I would not pick DPRjones because I think he's a much sharper and more astute. So I appreciate the opportunity to debate him. What we've heard tonight is a lot of ad hominem attacks upon myself and emotive language. DPRjones has not attacked the main premises of presuppositional apologetics concerning logic. In order to prove that I'm wrong, he needs to use the law of non-contradiction. So why is he saying, trying to argue against me? While he's arguing against me, he's got to use the law of non-contradiction. So if he's saying that the law of non-contradiction is not applicable, then why is he using the law of non-contradiction? So he's shot himself in the foot there. Then he says morality is relative. We heard him say that, and yet he's shot himself in the foot saying that homosexuality is condemning me for my beliefs about homosexuality. But yet he said morality is relative, so why is he doing that? He's not proved in any way about homosexuality that it's objective. So, you know, he's not dealt with the philosophical arguments there. I think he's quite capable of doing that, but he didn't do that. And then thirdly, we've not heard any arguments against the resurrection, really. He's not entered the scholarship there, and I think the reason why he's not entered the scholarship there is because he knows that he'll lose the argument. So, on the issue of religion and Islam, and he said about, you know, that I demolished Islam about this archaeological evidence, and how can you say that when the Bible's got loads of historical mistakes? Well, in the book of Acts, in the Gospel of John, there are 59 historical facts in the Gospel of John. Read Craig Bloomberg's The Historical Reliability of John's Gospel. But I can also give you secular historians who say the book of Acts is extremely reliable, 84 facts. F.F. Bruce talks about the Hittite Empire. The scholars said the Hittite Empire did not exist. The Bible said they did. We've discovered the Hittite Empire. And F.F. Bruce talks about how the Bible mentions that. So the Bible has been verified historically time and time again. Someone who studied theology for 10 years and looked at the liberal critics, I went to a liberal seminary, listened to liberal scholars for over 5 to maybe longer years, and I listened to them, and I've sat under them, and I've listened to them, and I can tell you this, that the Bible comes out on top time and time again, historically. But I just want to get on. I've got 6 minutes, so I want to... He used evolution, arguments from evolution. What I'd like to know about DPRjones and evolution, if I've got my notes, when you need your notes, you can't find your notes. Forgot my notes. Let's see. Sorry about this. When you want your notes, you can't find your notes. Sorry about this. When I want my notes, I can't find my notes. Sorry about this. Here we are.
I'm more than happy to allow Jason the next few minutes.
Thanks, mate. Thanks. Evolution. He talks about evolution. What I'd like to know from DPRjones. Does he believe in scientific censorship? I found out recently that Dawkins stopped a guy from publishing in the Times Higher Education Supplement. And then this guy who published in the Times Supplement, who they wouldn't allow the article to go in, Richard Milton, ask questions about evolution. And he talks about, in 1981, molecular biologists working under Dr. Morris Goodman at Ann Arbor University decided to test this hypothesis. They took the alpha homobolin DNA of two reptiles, a snake and a crocodile, which are said by Darwinists to be closely related, and the homo-goblin DNA of a bird in the case of a farmyard chicken. They found that the two animals who had at least DNA sequence in common were the two reptiles, the snake and the crocodile. They had only around 5% of DNA sequence in common, only 1/20th of their hemoglobin DNA. The two creatures whose DNA was closest were the crocodile and the chicken, where there were 7.5% of sequence in common. Nearly 1/5 the actual DNA similarities were the reverse of that predicted by neo-Darwinism. And you can read the article. I'm not saying this guy's a great scientific scholar, but what I'm saying is, why are these questions about evolution not being allowed to be heard in the academic arena and being suppressed? Why was that article actually published in was stopped by Dawkins from being published? On the historical issue about the resurrection, basically, the resurrection is based in eyewitness accounts. Dr. Borkum, one of the great scholars of today and an atheist, from Sheffield, Crosley from Sheffield, an atheist scholar, said that Balcom's book, Jesus and the Eyewitnesses, are a worthy book to be discussed by secular thinkers. And what Borkum did is he studied the biographies of first century Roman historians and Greeks. And what he noticed in Luke chapter 1, verse 1 to 3, where Luke says he looks at eyewitnesses, he noticed that ancient historians of the first century valued history based on eyewitness accounts. So you have Greek historians before the time of Jesus, during the time of Jesus, and after the time of Jesus, looking for eyewitness account material. So when Luke and the other Gospels are writing, in the context, the historical context, there would have been eyewitness material in what they're written. So the resurrection is based on eyewitness material. Secondly, also oral tradition. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 15, it says, these are first importance. And that word first importance is direct historical information concerning the rabbis, the way they did oral tradition. They passed on what they saw, what they thought to their students. The students were trained to a high degree of memory to remember and regurgitate the facts. So oral tradition was not like today. It was not a chicken thing where things changed over time. They were trained to memorize things and to pass it on in detail. In fact, if you look at culture today, all books, all things, in fact, I'll just prove to you this. Plato says that the sophist Hippias of Helae was able to repeat 50 names after hearing them once. Pliny the Elder reports that Cyrus was able to name every man in his army and that Lucius Scipio remembered the names of every person in the Roman Empire. Seneca boasted of being able in his youth to repeat 2,000 names read to him. In other words, when you look at the historical context where the Gospels were written, eyewitness material and oral tradition was important, and it was extreme high order for passing on information. And so when we're looking at the Gospels, we're looking at eyewitness material and we're looking at good, solid historical material to verify whether Jesus literally died and rose again. I could say a lot more if I got with it. There's so much I could say. I thought it was going to go on to other topics, but I'll stick with the eyewitness material. That cannot be controverted. The scholarly opinion now is a lot of atheists are banging on about Jesus is a myth, Jesus is a myth. Not even Bart Ehrman says that. But a lot of them are Mithraists. That's been demolished. We had Dr. Price on Live Life 8072, and they're talking about Jesus came from Mithraism. It's all been demolished. It's all old stuff because of Borkum's book and other books that have showed that this is based on eyewitness material, good oral tradition. James Dunn, one of the great scholars of today, not a believer that I believe that believes in the same kind of things as me, saying that there's eyewitness material, good solid historical material in the Gospels. Things are changing, my friends. The scholarship's moving in the place of orthodoxy of what we believe about the resurrection. It's moving apace. Just quickly, the scholarship that DPR uses for the resurrection, Earl Doughty, people like that. Fringe scholars. I know it's ad hominem, but it's important. The scholars that we're using, top mainstream scholars, okay? We'll get back to some more of that in a minute. All right, take care and thank you. Have I got some more time? 2 minutes, okay. Oral tradition. In the Qumran text, if you look at Qumran, let's just get, sorry, I can get my notes. if you look at Qumran, the Qumran text, they believed in the importance of writing, making sure they write everything down. So it's really crazy to think that the Gospels developed over like 70, 80 years of just passing on chicken like over time and changing, when everybody in those days were making notes. So there was not only oral tradition, people were writing things down. And so there's a good literary faithfulness in ancient historiography as well, of writing notes down. And these all culminate in the Gospels. So when we're reading the Gospels, we're supposedly trying to read about history. And we can verify the basic facts. Notice this about the Gospels. Listen to this about the Gospels, okay? This is really important. The Gospels are based in eyewitness material, and modern scholarship is moving in that direction. Once you get eyewitness material, the atheists can say there are contradictions in the Gospels. They can ooh and ah and all that they want. But once you've got eyewitness material, you've got something to get your teeth into historically. Okay? And that's the main thing I want to say there. So thank you for listening. So Qumran and Balkan scholarship and ancient historians, okay.
All right, I want to make a couple closing statements here and thank each of you for participating. Thank you, DPR and Jason, for your time and your efforts. I think it was good. I think if there's anybody who is truly going to watch this video that is neutral, that they will find interesting points on both sides. So thank you to everybody who watched, and that's it. Take care.